Hey everyone, welcome to this week's video update exclusively for Pro Members. Today's Friday, January 24th. Hope you all had a great week, shortened week. Obviously, Monday was the Martin Luther King holiday, so no trading on Monday, but fairly active the rest of the week. Before we jump into the alerts and our current positions in the community, who got caught being hot this week goes to Timothy Wilson. So Timothy's new to the community, but jumped in, started answering questions. And then this week also posted a question via a little quick video. So really like that. You know, if you all have any questions that you just would rather not sit there and type out, it'd be easier to explain with a quick video. Loom.com is a great little resource. It's free. All you got to do is download it, and then you can just literally click a button, record your screen, post the link into the community, and you don't have to show your face if you don't want to. Timothy chose to, which is cool. But anyway, quick little video that was a great question, and I'm going to address it a little bit more here on this update as we go through some of the different trades. So good work, Timothy. Congrats, you got caught being hot. The other thing I want to reference in the community here is if you go to events, we've got our upcoming new strategy class, the Portfolio Bunker strategy class. You just go to events. You can click on that. There's a quick little kind of overview video, and then scroll down and click here to register. That'll bring you to the registration page, and that's where you can save your spot. So make sure you attend. It's going to be a good one. You're going to want to attend. For all you pro members, which everybody listening to this is a pro member, this will be recorded, and we will, you know, cut it up into sections, edit it into sections for you, and it will become one of the classes. So if you cannot attend live, it will be available, but try to be there if you can, because it's good stuff. And the timing, I think, is critical too. So look forward to that. And that's on Tuesday next week, January 28th at 4 p.m. Central Time. So look forward to seeing you then. Let's jump into the alerts, starting with Tuesday the 21st. So the first alert was an opening adjusting trade in /ZW, which is wheat. And we just closed out, this is when we added the iron condor in ZW. So we had a short call vertical left from a previous iron condor, and then we just added this one. So go to the analyze tab here. You see we closed that piece out. That was an alert today, but this is the one that we opened from that alert. You can see price is still dead centered, so nothing to do but wait on that piece. Next trade, opening trade in Netflix. So we put on a earnings reverse iron duck in Netflix. This one with just 3 days to expiration. That's what we like to do when they're announcing that day. So we put that on. And then we ended up taking it off the next day right here and just closed that out and booked a big profit on that trade. So quick winner in Netflix. I did a closing trade in BA, Boeing. So we had a pre-earnings long straddle in Boeing. And let me go to the chart of Boeing and take a look at that. That was quite a move in Boeing. And what happened is they came out and said basically, hey, you know, we're going to be delaying the release of the MAX flight airplane. And so that kind of sent the world into a little bit of a tiff. And they announced some news was coming. And so trading actually halted at one point in Boeing. And so, but you can see this is the big day that we got out. So we put this on right here on this day, right near the open when price is trading right here. The first day, it traded down. We were profitable, held it over the weekend, and then this was Tuesday, had that big move down. So we booked a really nice profit on that. It was a good time to take winners because it did rebound the next couple days. So next trade was a closing trade in Netflix. I already mentioned that one. Rolling adjusting trade in QQQ. So we had one set of our short call verticals that was in February. Still had 30 days to expiration, but with price extending higher, it was to a position where it was, you know, pretty small chance of getting back into range. So we just rolled it out, got it back to a positive theta position, and adjusted the strikes accordingly. So and moved that out to March with at that point 58 days to expiration. So let's take a look at the Qs. We've still got those two sets of short call verticals. This is the one in Feb that we still have. Price is hanging out right here, trying to get back into range. And then the one that we rolled from that alert, you can see is in range and has come down a little bit since we put that on. So holding those for that short delta exposure. And so that is the QQQ. Next trade, opening adjusting trade in gold. So we added an iron condor in gold. We had a little bit of a pop-up in implied volatility, got up the IV percentile, got up to over 50. So we went ahead and added an iron condor in gold. So if we take a look, we've still got two pieces on here. We've got the short call vertical that was from our previous iron condor. So we're holding this, hoping to get that back into range and get a little bit of down movement there. And then the piece that we added is this new iron condor, where you can see price is pretty close to where we put it on. So just waiting on that one. Both of these are in the March cycle with 32 days to expiration. So even on that short call vertical, we've got a lot of time to see if that one can come back into range on gold. So gold just being kind of giving us a little smiley face right here, but we'll be keeping our eye on that one. Next trade, opening trade in CL. So oil moving around, implied volatility popping up. And so we took a position in oil, sold some premium in our good buddy CL. You can see ever since the Iran thing, where, you know, at first oil spiked up and then immediately went down and has continued to slide down in dramatic fashion. So we sold some premium with implied volatility. Price is pretty close to where we put it on. So just going to wait and get some more theta to decay in oil. Next trade, opening trade in Netflix. So we put on another reverse iron duck in Netflix. So Netflix was moving up pretty significantly on that day that we put it on, which is this big green bar right here. So we put it on when price was up quite a bit, about right here, and it just continued to escalate the next day. Today, which is Friday, it popped up higher. Now it's come down. So if we take a look at our duck, you can see price is hanging out right in the middle of our duck head. Now, after one thing to comment, there's a comment in the community about, you know, after we put it on and price moved higher, there's a comment like, you know, what are we going to do with this? You know, price is moving higher, but price was hanging out right in the middle of the duck head, which is exactly where we want it. So when we put these trades on, if it moves against us, that doesn't mean we get out real quick. We have our specific criteria for a reason. You know, we're going to let these play out. You got to let the probabilities play out. You can't bail early or bail late just because you have a gut feeling about something. You've got to let the probabilities play out. And obviously price has kind of retracted back to the middle. And, you know, who knows? I mean, this thing could skyrocket and we'll have to, you know, get out, but we don't do that until it happens. And we've set these criteria of exiting at 100% of kind of the initial credit for a reason, because that's the maximum, that maximizes our profitability over time. We don't trade based on gut feel or, you know, anything like that. If you want to trade directionally on Netflix, be my guest, go ahead, you know, take a, you know, sell a put spread or buy a call spread or buy some calls or whatever. But if you're trading these strategies, you gotta use the criteria that we teach. Let those probabilities play out. You know, you're not all of them are going to be winners. You know, there is the small number of losers as well, but you got to let the probabilities play out. Taking losses is part of the game, and you got to be able to do that as well. You got to take the winners with the losers. Okay, next trade. Okay, so this was the one today, this morning in Intel. Now, I mentioned this in the Trade Hacker update yesterday, that they had announced earnings. They were above the expected move, and that's where we like to take these post-earnings short put verticals. So I announced it then, about 15 or 20 minutes before the market opened. I announced, hey, we're going to be looking at short puts and short put verticals in Intel. So with these types of trades, these things can move very quickly. So, you know, trying to wait for the alert and wait for the fill and get, you know, then place it yourself. You know, at that point, I know a lot of people didn't get into this trade. And if we take a look at the charts, INTC, you know, this thing opened up and just boom, shot higher. So you know, we got in pretty close to after the market opened and got filled and sent the alert out, I mean, within seconds. And so that's just part of, you know, the markets being open, the markets being moving. If we look at the intraday, you know, here's what happened. This is a 5-minute chart. So, I mean, boom, I mean, it just shot up within 10 minutes. It was up here. So you've got to be ready for those. You know, if you're going to take those, you know, it's almost like you can't wait for the alert. You know, we give a heads up of what we're looking at, but we can't, you know, we don't, you know, when the market opened, I looked at short puts, short put verticals. I looked at different expiration cycles. And so I don't know which strikes I'm going to trade until the market opens. And so, you know, that's why I say you gotta kind of be on top of that one. And keep in mind, I mean, this is exactly why we teach the courses. You know, we teach you step by step by step exactly when to place this trade. And so, you know, this is one that, you know, if you're waiting for the alert, sometimes it's going to run away. Now, again, sometimes it's not, right? I mean, sometimes it's going to, you know, it's going to open up and it's going to fade back down. And so you'd actually get a better fill price and then it takes off, you know? So it just, you just don't know, but you've got to learn the strategies. And I think that's so critical. And you know, sometimes we get comments and going back to Timothy Wilson, who posted the video on the, on, you know, sometimes I will, you know, put the trade on to analyze it and it's not trading at the same price. Well, remember on Netflix as the other example, you know, this thing we put on right here and then it just continued higher pretty quickly. The next day it was even higher. And so the question that Tim posted in that video was, should I still get in? And he's looking at it from this standpoint where price is right here in the middle of the duck head. You know, so this, would we put it on and center price at that point? Absolutely not. That's not the criteria that we teach for putting on these trades. Is it still a valid trade? Yeah. Heck yeah. I would look to even put on another one of these, you know, but with the criteria that we teach in the class, we're not going to put it on at the same strikes. You're not going to get the same fill. That's not how trading works. So you've got to be able to learn the strategies. You cannot blindly follow these alerts. That is just, that's not part of the game. So I know some newer traders kind of come in and they, you know, trading options is not easy, right? You actually have to learn it. You have to put in some work. You have to put in the effort to make this happen. And, you know, when we send out an alert, the fill price that we get, we typically don't, unless we're going to close a trade. Sometimes we got in closing trades, we'll put it in order and let it sit for a while. But on opening trades, we don't put in orders and let them sit for hours. Okay. We look at them, we adjust the strikes, we adjust the prices, the expiration cycles, all the different things. And we're trying to get filled right away. And so our fill price is only relevant to the time that we are placing the trade, because our alerts go out within 30, 60, 90 seconds at the latest. And so, but still, when the markets are open, the markets are moving. And so if you're trying to get the fill price, sometimes you're going to get filled at better prices than us. Sometimes you're going to get filled at not as good prices as us. Sometimes you're going to have to adjust your strikes, but you've got to take ownership of that. You cannot chase other people's fills. I don't know how else to say this. If you're chasing somebody else's fills, you're either going to get filled at better prices or worse prices or not at all, or you're going to adjust your strikes and make it your own. My suggestion is you've got to use these alerts as trade ideas. Anytime somebody posts a trade in the community, I don't even pay attention to the fill price that they got. That is irrelevant. That was relevant to the time that they put it on. Could have been 5 minutes ago, could have been 2 minutes ago, could have been 2 hours ago. It doesn't matter. But the reality is you have to look at the trade alerts as trade ideas and tweak them and massage them to A, fit into your portfolio. You know, you shouldn't be doing necessarily the same size as us. You shouldn't be doing the same anything as us. You should look at that as a trade idea and see if it fits in your portfolio. Put it in. If it fits, great. If you need to adjust the strikes because price has moved, great. Do that and make it happen. There's nothing magical about the prices that we get filled at. It's simply the time that we put the trade in. So I hope that's helpful, because there, you know, I get comments sometimes about, you know, it's hard to get the same fill price as us. Well, yeah, I know. Markets move. They're open. Sometimes you get filled at better, sometimes at worse. But anyway, that's what you got to do. And guys, keep in mind, I get so many emails a day. I get from newer traders. I get it from our experienced traders. And traders send me their P&Ls, and the traders who are doing the best and are beating our alerts portfolio. We have so many members that are beating the performance of our alerts portfolio. And the only reason why is because they are taking ownership of their trading. They're using the alerts as trade ideas, but they're making it their own size, their own strikes, their own everything. So please make sure that that's what you're doing. If you're blindly trying to follow the alerts with our fill, it's just, it's a losing battle. And so you don't want to do that. So hopefully that helps. That's my rant for the day. So please take it to heart, because I want you guys to succeed more than anything. There, you know, I had one somebody email me and say something about how we get favorable fills. And I'm just like, what are you talking about? We get the same fills everybody else does. I mean, we don't have any inside information from TD Ameritrade or any inside track or fill source. I mean, we're putting the trades in just like you guys. And so that's what you got to do, guys. Just take ownership of your trades and don't try to chase somebody else's fills. That is a losing battle. All right. So next trade, what else we got here? Intel wheat. That was the closing trade. So we closed out that short call vertical. Closing trade in Intel. So yeah, so the other thing is we got in this trade and just literally an hour later, we got out of the trade, booked a profit. By the way, I think when the alert went out, it said we booked 50% of max profit. That's what I was initially wanting. We ended up just getting 25% pretty quick. So I just closed it out. So I went in and adjusted that. So we booked 25% of max profit, not 50, as it said in the email that you got. The other thing I mentioned is, you know, we almost never get in a trade and out of the trade the same day. But in this case, obviously we did because it moved so quickly. Just remember, if you get in and out of a trade, if your account's under 25K, you only have 3 day trades per week. So you got to be aware of that. Closing trade in RUT. So this one, I was hoping we'd get a little bit of a bounce higher in the morning in RUT and we could close this out. But we did not. The market is going down for once, which I'm going to get to here in a minute. But RUT, we ended up taking a loss on this one. Price never gave us that bounce that we needed today to book a profit. It just kind of fell apart. So good stuff for a lot of our portfolio, but was hoping to book a little profit on that RUT trade. But we today was the last trading day, so we needed to get out of that one. Opening trade in FXI, so Chinese large cap. So IV spiked in FXI today, and with a little bit of down movement, so up in the 90 plus level on the IV percentile. So we sold some premium, sold a strangle. Now I mentioned this in the alert, but if you go to the trade tab, you've got to. We did this with 56 days. You know, we did this at the, you know, at this point, it's about the 30 delta, 27 delta. So this is a little bit closer to the money than we like, but FXI is such a low price symbol. It's only $42 that you've got to get closer. We like to collect at least at buck when we're trading these short strangles. And so that's what we had to do. We had to go closer to the money. So it's not going to give you as high of a probability of profit, but the max profit is a little bit bigger by squeezing these strikes in. So that's what we did. And as I also mentioned, we are going to close this a little sooner. So 30 to 40% as opposed to, we probably won't wait till 50% of max profit. We'll close it a little quicker. So those are all the alerts. Before we go into the current positions, I want to talk about the market a little bit in general. So if we look at the S&P, obviously a sweet down day today, down 37. Now we've still got a couple hours before the market closes. I'm recording this a couple hours before the market closes. S&P's down 37. And what I want to point out is a couple things. One, if we look at the weekly expected move, You know, this thing has just been staying inside the expected move until last week. And I don't think I mentioned this on last week's video, but it actually broke out and closed well above the expected move. This week, kind of trading. And then right now, it's basically tagging the lower end of the expected move. This will be set more when once the market closes. So it's still adjusting, but with the down move, with the implied volatility spike, you can see we have a little bit bigger of a range that we're expecting next week. And so we'll see what happens there. But that is all good stuff from an implied volatility opportunity. Gives us more opportunity to sell some premium, open some new positions. So we'll definitely be doing that next week. The other thing I want to point out is I've mentioned a couple times, and this is relevant specifically to our upcoming strategy class, the bunker strategy, where we want to pay attention to the relationship between the movement in SPX or the S&Ps, which today is down almost exactly 1%, and the VIX. So on average, the VIX is going to move, you know, if the S&P is down 1%, the VIX is going to move up about 9%. Well, today it's up over 18% on a 1% down move in the SPX. Now, part of that has to do with the level of the VIX, right? So let me just go to a one-year chart. The level of the VIX matters, right? So if it's lower, 1 year daily, if the VIX is lower, and we have a down move in the S&P, you're going to get a larger, quicker move up in the VIX. So if the VIX was already up here at 22 and the S&P moved down 1%, it probably wouldn't move up 18%, right? It would be closer to the average. So the average move is about 9% per 1% move in SPX. But that's relevant because what we'll be talking about in the bunker class and you know, just the fact that there's so much complacency in the market. And, you know, unemployment is at all-time lows. We've got the, potential president impeachment. The market's shaking that off. We've got the trade wars. Market's shaking that off. We've got missiles from Iran. Market shakes that off like it's nothing. We've got all these different geopolitical issues, and the market is just shaking those off. Now, my thesis is, the next correction that we see, like major market correction, like more than a 20% decline in the market that we see, I think it's going to be something that we're not necessarily even aware of. You know, I don't think it's going to be a war with the Middle East. I don't think it's going to be, you know, the trade war, you know, all these different things that are going on. I think it's going to be something that we're not necessarily aware of. If any of you were trading or at least investing in 2008 during the financial crisis, now, everybody knew that the mortgage market was and the real estate market was a little crazy, right? I mean, I think everybody knew, hey, you know, people are getting loans that they probably shouldn't, blah, blah, blah. What's that going to do? But there's all these, you know, huge investment banks backing these papers. What we didn't know was the credit default swaps and the leverage that was happening behind the scenes. Unless you were in that space, very few people knew of that whole situation. And that's what really created that massive collapse of Bear Stearns, Lehman Brothers, and some of the major issues that we had. And so I think if we see another, you know, black swan type event or a market crash or correction, it's going to be something that that's not in plain daylight. You know, it's not in plain sight of all the things that are going on right now. It's going to be something that's kind of unknown. And so that's just kind of my take. But this bunker class that we're talking about, you know, we're going to be utilizing strategies, on VIX and some of these different ways that we can help protect our accounts. Not only is it going to allow us to protect our account, but it's going to allow us to be more aggressive and go for better returns with the rest of our portfolio. So it's really good stuff. So again, make sure you're there Tuesday on the 28th. Okay, so let's go over some of our other positions. We've got oil. I mentioned ES, we've got this long put vertical that we're holding for short delta. Our short delta loves days like today. This one price is still just outside range. Need a little bit more to get back in on that. I mentioned gold. Natty gas moving down a little bit today. We've got two different pieces here. We've got our regular short strangle that's not adjusted. Price is hanging out right here. If it moves much lower, we are going to roll our calls down. There's not too much premium left in those calls, but there's a little bit of juice. So we'll give it a little bit more time. Obviously, if it bounces higher, we'll be good to go. If not, we will roll our calls down. And then we've got our adjusted, our inverted strangle, which is kind of outside of our range, but it's the same story. If we look at just the calls here, you can see, you know, we've got a tiny bit of juice left in those. So if price continues lower, we're going to roll down those calls, collect another credit, and continue to manage that one. Bonds. Okay, so bonds have come back really nicely. I was almost going to, when price was hanging out right here, I was almost going to add, a couple times I tried to add a centered short strangle around where price was, but price has really shot up. And so it's pretty dead centered here. Now we're only about a couple hundred dollars away from booking, getting back to break even on this trade that we've been kind of rolling and adjusting for the last couple months. And so we're just holding this for now. We have, 28? Yeah, 28 days to expiration. And so next week, we will look to either close this or we will potentially roll it out to the next cycle, collect another credit, and give it a little bit more time to get back to profitability. So bonds doing some good stuff. And, you know, all we need is a little bit of a contraction in implied volatility. So if we look at TLT, which is the corresponding ETF, you know, obviously with the market going down, bonds going up today, implied volatility spiking, you know, if things just kind of settle down next week and just kind of trade sideways for a couple days and implied volatility contracts, we'll probably just get out of this book a winner and then look to potentially, you know, re-enter if implied volatility pops back up. So that is the plan in bonds. I mentioned wheat, Apple. So, I mean, look at this. Apple's crazy. So the market's down, you know, 40 points. The S&P's down 40. Apple, it's down just not even a quarter of a percent. So it was up a lot more, and it's come down off of its highs, but Apple is just unbelievably strong. Now, we do have earnings coming up next week on the 28th. So that's Tuesday after the market closes. So right when we're presenting our bunker strategy, Apple will be announcing earnings. And so we'll see what happens. We're going to hold our trade, obviously, through that. We're holding this for that short delta exposure. At some point, this has got to get a little bit of a downside relief. So we will see what happens in Apple. John Deere, same thing. We're holding this for downside exposure, and we got a little bit of that today. You can see prices hanging out right here. If this continues lower, to keep this short delta, we'll just kind of move these strikes closer, and then we'll roll out to March. But right now, we're just kind of holding. DIA, we've got these two sets of short call verticals, one in Feb, where price is just outside the range, and then this one in March, where price is right here, just inside the range. FXI, I mentioned. IWM, we've got a long put vertical with this down move, getting us a little profit on that one. Just holding that for the short delta exposure as well. By the way, our short delta exposure right now, kind of our range, you know, and I haven't talked about this much in a couple weeks, but our range of short delta versus our theta, if we beta weight it to SPY, we like to have between 1-to-1 and 5-to-1 of short delta versus our theta. And right now we're at about 1.5-to-1. So surprisingly, and that's after today's big down move, obviously, but with the market grinding higher, we have not accumulated as much short delta. And that's due to doing a lot of iron ducks as opposed to, you know, some other more delta neutral type strategies that we would, you know, manage and roll. So that's a good thing. I wouldn't mind having more short delta on a day like this, of course, but that's hindsight, so we can't play that way. So that's IWM. Netflix, I mentioned that one. QQQ, I mentioned that one. SPX, we've got two ducks. So I've actually been trying to get out of this one all week. And this is the one that expires next week. It was at a point, now that the market's moved down, we're in a different situation, so it might end up coming back to benefit us. But this one, when price was way up here, we had less than a 10% chance of getting back into the duck head. And so I was trying to close that out for big profit. And I wasn't going to pay more than $5, which is the width of our call spread. But I was trying to get out for $5 or less and just never got filled. And so now price is coming back down. So we'll see if it can continue down for us. But so we'll just hold on to that until expiration at this point. Then the other one that we have expires on Feb 5. So price is hanging out right here, just starting to potentially enter the duck head area. So if we take off this one next week, we'll add another SPX iron duck to kind of ladder into this at a longer time frame, probably with anywhere from 14 to 21 days. If we get another big down move in the market and we get this implied volatility really popping, we can start doing some shorter term ducks kind of in that, you know, 7-14 day range. So that's always a lot of fun. SPY, we've got this short call vertical. Price is hanging out right here. Need a little bit more down movement to get back into range there. Tesla, big move down today. Well, actually, compared to what Tesla's been doing, not much of a move, but down 2.5%. So price is hanging out kind of mid-range. It's come all the way back down, starting to enter the beak area now. So remember, they announce on the 29th after the market closes. So we'll have to see where we're at. I mean, if price is hanging out, you know, down here, that's just like putting on a duck right before earnings, which we might do anyway. So in that case, we would just hold on to it. If price is way up here, you know, I don't necessarily know if I want to run the risk of a huge gap higher overnight with earnings, and then we take a big loss. So it depends on where price is before they announce. If we're up in this beak area, we'll leave it on. If we are, you know, way up here, we'll probably take it off. If we're somewhere right here, it's kind of gray area. I'd probably leave it on, but I'll make sure I post something to kind of remind you, and you can make the choice on what you think's best. Lastly, XLK, we've got a long put vertical here for that short delta. Need some more downside to get that one back into range. A couple other things that I'm looking at for next week. XBI has got some good juice to it now as well. XBI. I was looking at selling some premium in here as well. We added FXB or FXI, and you know, I don't want to just load the boat and start selling premium on the first down day that we've seen in what feels like 3 months, but getting a good spike in implied volatility here. So if that stays high into next week, we'll be selling some premium in XBI. What else do I got? You know, some of these, interestingly enough, some of these other, you know, XRT, the retail ETF, I mean, implied volatility is coming up a little bit, but not too much. XLF is another one that's starting to get near that 50 level with a big move down today. The banks fall, the market, the banks go down, the market's going to follow. So that's good to see. But some of these international, like EWZ, barely popping, and it's barely down. Now it's down over 1%, but implied volatility is barely moving. EWW Mexico, implied volatility is coming up, but still it's only at that 29 level on the percentile. EEM, you know, it's starting to come up, so that's another one that we'll look at. FXB, the British pound, and the euro, implied volatility is still super low in those. And then GLD, you know, we've got that iron condor and gold. TLT bonds, we've got a position in bonds, and so definitely some opportunity coming our way. And then, of course, a lot of earnings. Oh, that was the last thing I wanted to go. If we go to the Market Watch tab and the calendar, we can look at the different earnings coming up. So let's start with Monday. I don't think there was anything. I'll make sure I post this in the morning update. But nothing. I don't think there was any stocks that I was really excited about trading. But then on, as I mentioned, on Tuesday, we've got Apple. And then let's see what else. AMD, another one. Not a high price stock, but it's a very liquid stock. Let's see what else here. Cree. Cree is a decent one to trade. eBay, another smaller price, lower price stock, but a decent one to trade. And I'll post these on our kind of the current position and outlook post that we do in the community. Pfizer, PFE is another one. So earnings are starting next week, start getting into high gear. You can see there's 151 earnings announced on Wednesday. Now, you know, we only trade the big, most liquid ones. So Definitely not anything you need to be aware of as far as that many stocks, but you know, you've got Boeing, you've got Alibaba on Wednesday. So we will we'll post about those in the community, and I know you trade hackers will be sharing some earnings trade ideas, which is awesome. So look forward to that. Everybody have a great weekend. Look forward to talking to you next week. Have a good one.